Hello all, welcome to Broadcasting and Streaming Technique session. This is Dr. Sakimuthu. We are discussing about DVB-T transmission, terrestrial transmission. In that, today we are going to discuss about the single frequency networks.
DVB-T, single frequency networks, SFN. Look at the COFDM. The COFDM is well suited to single frequency operation. As the name indicates, in single frequency operation, all transmitter operate at the same frequency, which makes for a greater economy with regard to frequency resources. All transmitters radiate the identical signal and they have to operate in complete synchronization with each other. Signal from adjacent signals are seen by a transmitter as if they were simply echoes. Frequency synchronization is the easiest condition because frequency accuracy and stability had to meet high demands even in analog television. In DVB-T, the transmitter RF is locked to the best reference available. That is a signal from the GPS, Global Positioning System. The signal from the GPS, which is available throughout the world and is now also used for synchronizing the transmitting frequency of a DVB-T single frequency network. The GPS satellites radiate a 1 PPS, that is pulse per second. The GPS satellites radiate a 1 PPS signal to which a 10 MHz oscillator in professional GPS receivers is locked, which in turn acts as a reference signal for the DVB-T transmitters. So look at figure number 23, table 16, table 17, and table 18. There is a strict requirement with respect to the maximum distance between the transmitters. Look at figure number 23. This distance is related to the length of the guard interval and the velocity of light. The velocity of light, that is the associated signal delay. Okay. Inter-symbol interference, ISI, inter-symbol interference, can only be avoided if in the case of multipath reception, the delay on any path is longer than the delay, the length of the guard interval. The question about what will happen if the signal received from a more distant transmitter violates the guard interval is easily answered. It results in inter-symbol interference, which becomes a noticeable as noise in the receiver. Signals from transmitters at a greater distance must simply be attenuated sufficiently. The threshold for quasi-error-free operation is formed by the same conditions as for the pure noise. So it is therefore of particular importance that the levels in a single frequency network are calibrated correctly. It is not the maximum transmitting power at every transmitting site which is required, but the correct one. Planning of the network requires topographical information. In many cases, however, network planning is relatively simple since mostly only small regional single frequency networks with only very few transmitters are set up. The velocity of light is equal to C is equal to 3 into 10 power 8, right? Meter per second, which results in a signal delay per kilometer. Transmitter distance of T 1 kilometer is equal to 1000, that is equal to 3.336 microsecond. Since in the 8K mode, the guard interval is longer in absolute terms, it is mainly this mode which is provided for single frequency operation. Long guard intervals are provided for single frequency networks. Medium length guard intervals are used in regional networks. The short guard intervals finally are provided for local networks are used outside of single frequency networks. In a single frequency network, all the individual transmitters must be synchronized with one another. The program contribution is injected from the playout center in which the MPEG-2 multiplexer is located, example via satellite, optical fiber or microwave link. It is clear, it's very clear that the MPEG-2 transport streams are subject to different feed line delays due to different path lengths. However, it is necessary that in each DVB-T modulator in an SFN network, the same transport stream packets are processed into COFDM symbols. Every modulator must perform every operating step completely synchronously with all the other modulators in the network. Every modulator must perform operations completely synchronously with all other modulators in the network, the same network. The same packets, the same bits and the same bytes must all be processed at the same time. Every DVB-T transmitter site must broadcast absolutely identical COFDM symbols at exactly the same time. The DVB-T modulation is structured in frames, one frame being composed of 68 DVB-T COFDM symbols. Within a frame, the complete TPS information is transmitted and the scattered pilots are scattered over the entire DVB-T channel. Four such frames in turn make up one super frame. Means the frame structure of DVB-T is 68 COFDM symbols equal to one frame, four such frame is equal to one super frame. One super frame in DVB-T accommodates an integer number of MPEG-2 transport stream packets. Look at table number 19. The number of transport stream packets per super frame are given for different code rate in QPSK, 16 QAM and 64 QAM, in 2K mode and 8K mode. In consequence, a super frame in a single frequency network must be composed of absolutely identical transport stream packets, and each modulator in the SFN must generate and broadcast the super frame at the same time. These modulators must therefore be synchronized with one another. And in addition, the differences in the feed line delays must be equalized statically and dynamically. To achieve this, packets with the timestamps are inserted into the MPEG-2 transport stream in the playout center. These packets are special transport stream packets which are configured similarly to a MPEG-2 table, PSI and SI table. For this purpose, the transport stream is divided into sections. The section length of which are selected to be approximately a half second, because they must correspond to a certain integral number of transport stream packets fitting into a certain integral number of super frames. These sections are called mega frames. So a mega frame is composed of an integral number of super frames, which means one mega frame is equal to two super frames in 8K mode, one mega frame is equal to eight super frames in 2K mode. Okay, the one PPS signals of the GPS satellites are also used for synchronizing the timing of DVB-T modulators. Look at figure number 24. In the case of single frequency network, there is a professional GPS receiver outputting both a 10 MHz reference signal and this one PPS time signal at every transmitter site and at the playout center, where the multiplex stream is assembled. The playout center will assemble the multiplex streams. At the multiplex site, there is a so-called MIP inserter, which inserts this special transport stream packets into one mega frame in each case, which is why this packet is called a mega frame initializing packet, MIP, mega frame initializing packet. The MIP has a special PID of hexadecimal 15. MIP has got a special PID, 15, hexadecimal 15, so that it can be identified, and it contains time reference and control information for the DVB-T modulators. Among other things, it contains a time counting back to the time the last 1 PPS signal, 1 PPS pulse was received at the MIP inserter. This timestamp with a resolution of 100 nanosecond steps is used for automatically measuring the feed distance. This time information is evaluated by the SFN adapter, which automatically corrects the delay from the playout center to the transmitter side by means of a buffer store. It also requires information about the maximum delay in the network. Given this information, which can either be input manually at every transmitter site, or is carried in the MIP packet, each SFN adapter adjusts itself to this time. The MIP packets also contains a pointer to the start of the next mega frame in number of TS packets. Look at figure number 25. The MIP packets contains a pointer to the start of the next mega frame in numbers of TS packets. Using this pointer information, each modulator is then able to start a mega frame at the same time. The length of the mega frame depends on the length of the guard interval, and it depends upon the guard interval and on the bandwidth of the channel. The narrower the channel, the longer the COFDM symbols, since the subcarrier spacing becomes very less. Every DVB-T modulator can now be synchronized by means of the information contained in the MIP packets. The MIP packets can always be transmitted at a fixed position in the mega frame, but this position is also allowed to vary. So look at the table number 20. In the table number 20, I have given the duration of a mega frame. It contains a list of exact length of one mega frame. So based on the guard interval, 8 megahertz channel, 7 megahertz channel, 6 megahertz channel, I have given the duration of the mega frame. In MIP, an MIP can also be used for transmitting additional information such as the DVB-T transmission parameters, which makes it possible to control and configure the entire DVB-T SFN from one center. For example, it can be used for changing the type of modulation, the code rate, the guard interval length, other things. However, although this is possible, it may not be supported by every DVB-T modulator. If the transmission of the MIP packets stops for some reason, or if the information in the MIP packets is corrupted, then what happens? Then the single frequency network will lose synchronization. If a DVB-T transmitter detects that it has dropped lock, and if a DVB-T transmitter detects that it has dropped lock, or that it has not received a GPS signal for some time, and the 1 PPS reference and the 10 MHz reference have been drifted, so it has to go off air, or it will only be a source of noise in the single frequency network. Look at figure number 26. A reliable reception is then only possible with the directional reception close to the transmitter. For this reason, the MIPs in the transport stream arriving at the transmitter are often monitored by using an MPEG-2 test decoder. In figure number 26, mega frame initializing packet, that clearly shows that the multiplexed MPEG-2 stream, correct, is now carrying a further table like packets, namely a MIP packet. This packet contains the synchronization timestamp, the pointer and the minimum maximum delay. The MAP packets contains the synchronization timestamp, the pointer and the maximum delay. So look at figure number 27. Okay, this contains the transmission parameters also. It can also be seen that every transmitter in the link up can be addressed like a table. The content of the MAP packet is protected by a CRC checksum. In addition, each transmitter can also be pushed. That is, it is possible to change the time when the COFDM symbol is broadcast. This will not push the single frequency network out of the synchronization, but only vary the delay of the signals of the transmitters with respect to each other. And it can thus be used for optimizing the SFN network. These time offsets are found in the TX time offset functions in figure number 27. Shifting the broadcasting time makes it appear to the receiver as if the geographic position of the respective transmitter has changed. This may be of interest if two transmitters in an SFN are very fast. If two transmitters in an SFN are very far apart and are approaching the limit of the guard interval, for example, DVB-T network Southern Bavaria with the Olympic Tower in Munich and the Mount Wendelstein transmitter at a distance of 63 km. Or if the guard interval has been chosen to be very short for reasons of data rates. For example, in Australia, Sydney, the G value is 1/16. So in the next session, we will discuss about minimum receiver input level required with the DVB-T.